So hi, everyone. Thank you for joining us in this panel on human capital. My name is Gonzalo Schwartz. I'm the founder and CEO of the Archbridge Institute, a think tank in Washington focused on lifting barriers to social mobility and human flourishing. And as a short story, yesterday, Jim Carolla and Agustin Echevarne and I visited the Secretary of Education and the Secretary of Early Childhood, Adolescence, and Family. And they're both now under the Minister of Human Capital, a new ministry that the Argentinian government created by merging three different ministries. So the Ministry of Education, Early Childhood and Family, and also the Ministry of Labor, which I personally think is an excellent decision for reasons that we'll discuss on this panel. But when we started the meeting, Jim asked them very politely, what are your roles, or basically, why do you have a job if there's already a Minister of Human Capital? And it wasn't exactly phrased like that, and it was definitely very polite, but I think it was appropriate to bring that to our conversation today because human capital is about building skills throughout the life cycle of a person, which includes many aspects related to family, early childhood education, health, education during the school years, and certainly skills that people learn for the labor market and in the labor market. So the main point is that you can't untangle all of these things that are interrelated and connected throughout a person's life as they build the skills that will help them live successful and flourishing lives. So what you will hear today during the panel, we have four stellar academics and researchers who have studied these issues throughout their careers and will try to make those connections for us. You have their full bios in the event app, so I will just provide brief introductions now for the four of them. And as they're talking, you can, again, go to the app and submit your questions there, and we'll have a Q&A period at the end. So first we'll have James Heckman. So Jim is the Henry Schultz Distinguished Professor in Economics at the University of Chicago. He's also a senior fellow with the Archbridge Institute. He has been in Chicago's Department of Economics since 1973, and in 2014 he launched the Center for the Economics of Human Development, which he still leads. In 2000, he won the Nobel Prize in Economics, and he has won many other accolades in economics, being one of the most cited economists in the profession, but I think most relevant to this discussion. He has dedicated his life to studying social mobility, human flourishing, and social capital. Second, we'll have Carola Pessino, who is the senior economist in the fiscal management division of the Inter-American Development Bank. She's in charge of coordinating knowledge in fiscal policy and management, and has led and collaborated in several fiscal strengthening programs in the region. She holds a master's degree in economics from USEMA University, a master's degree and a PhD from the University of Chicago. And she's the Secretary of Fiscal Equity of the Chief of Cabinet of Ministers in Argentina, and member of the Economic Council of Advisors to the Minister of Finance in Argentina between 1996 and 1999. Third, we'll have Eduardo Filgueira Lima. Eduardo is an international consultant in public health, health policies, and management of health services and insurance, having contributed to these areas with many organizations. He is a member of the Academic Council of Fundación Libertad y Progreso and a researcher and a university professor. He's a former Secretary of Health of the government of the province of La Pampa and a former Vice Minister of Health of the Ministry of Health in Argentina. And last but certainly not least, we'll have Martin Krauss. Martin is an adjunct scholar at the Cato Institute. He's a professor of economics at USEMA University in Buenos Aires and a visiting professor at the Universidad Francisco Marroquín in Guatemala and Universidad of the Hesperides. He also served as a rector of ESEADE and is a member of the Academic Council of Fundación Libertad y Progreso. And so without further ado, let's start with Jim, please. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jim.
Well, thank you very much for that introduction. I appreciate it. And I really appreciate the opportunity to be here, and in particular, to have a joint presentation with Carola Pessino. I'll give you a little bit of background about the talk that we're giving today. And when Carola was minister or secretary of fiscal equity here in the Menem government some 30 years ago, we developed a budget for Argentina, a skill budget for Argentina. And one of our suggestions was a Department of Human Capital that put together these integrated notions. And so today we get a chance to amplify on the theme, but to also strengthen our thinking about what we wrote 30 years ago and update it in light of a lot of new information that's been achieved. So what I want to argue, and I think this is our purpose today, is we want to argue that Argentina needs a skill-based learnings policy to promote dynamism and agency, and I mean ability to deal, the resiliency, the capacity to adapt and to take opportunities at all levels of society. And crucially, and I think this is missing in some of the programs, even the libertarian programs, is to teach children and to teach people and adults to internalize the values that promote flourishing and dynamic society. So one thing that we need to really get past, and I think this has been a mistake that many conservatives have made, they've adopted as the hero some of these people who make strong statements about genetics. The one thing we've learned in the last 30, 40, 50 years is that skills and preferences are not mainly genetically determined. There is a genetic basis, but there's a powerful role for influence, for education, and for learning. And I think people should harvest that information, and that's the main theme of our talk today. So what we've learned from a lot of work, a lot of research, is that skill gaps across socioeconomic groups open up very early. Skills are not set in stone at birth. They solidify as people age. They evolve and can be shaped. And when we say they can be shaped, that sounds like a menacing word. I'm not suggesting it be shaped by any particular government policy or by any particular bureaucrat, but the role of the family and the institutions of society that sustain society should be the primary shapers of learning and values. And so here's a graph that shows really what I'm saying. By the way, our talks are way too long. And what we're going to do instead is leave behind with you a very complete database, but we're going to only summarize that in our talks today. So you can see in this one score, in this one chart, which has been replicated in Colombia, in India, in China, but this is for the United States, that if you look at test scores of children over time, from age 3, when we can start measuring them accurately, to age 18, when they're making really important life decisions, that basically you can see that if the uppermost figure is that of the scores of the parents of the children whose parents are college educated, mothers college educated, and if you look at the bottom, those are the scores of children whose parents are dropouts. And what you can see is a profound difference between those two. And not only are the gaps substantial at 18, the gaps are substantial also at 3, certainly at 5, and they're maintained. And this is American data. And as a result, we have to really understand that a lot of the discussion about school quality and the quality of schools, the kind of technocratic discussion that dominates a lot of the international organizations, is really irrelevant. These children are going to vastly different schools. It's not that those schools are accelerating or diminishing, or that we can necessarily look to schools to close the gaps. I'm just asserting those gaps are there. And I also want to further assert that this is not an argument in favor of genetics primarily, or eugenics. What it is showing that those skills emerge early, and there's a possibility of doing something about it. So what I'm urging us to do today, and what I'm urging the Argentine policymakers to do, is to capitalize on the growing knowledge about skill and preference formation, and to really understand that even in the libertarian doctrine about having individual choice, we really need to come to terms with how individuals are created, how values are created. And that's a central part that I think has been neglected and left to technocrats and left to people who write in the schools of education. I have very strong political views, and we've been very silent in trying to understand how we can create those values and promote a sense of agency and engagement and dynamism, therefore, in the society. So I just want to make two observations, which is supported by a lot of empirical work. First of all, and this is very, very important, when you look at the skills of a country, you want to move beyond just PISA scores. I realize there's a huge sales job by the OECD. There's a huge interest in test scores all around the world. You go to China, and they talk about how their Shanghai students do very well, and they're the best schools in the world by PISA scores, and on and on and on. But we've come to understand the inadequacy of those measures. If we look at what really is relevant, what we really learn in school, what are really important skills that emerge, and I'm talking about emerging long before we even get into school, that is things like personality, creativity, the ability to cope with new problems, and to understand a variety of aspects of human flourishing, which we generally ignore in the kind of established educational establishment literature. And secondly, and this is an important theme, and Carola will talk more about this, is recognizing the importance of the early years in creating those skills. So the early years are primarily the family years and the neighborhood years, and the time when the children, a major source of learning is, of course, imitation. Parents are being imitated. The neighborhoods and the environments are being imitated by the children. Understanding that understands then a much deeper way to think about learning and creation and the formation of those skills. So what we've come to understand, and this is something that I would just harp on repeatedly, but I can't, I don't have time to do it, is that if we look, for example, at inequality across lifetime earnings, what we find that most of the factors that are accounting for that are not explained simply by things happening after people leave school. We also understand that IQ, as we measure it, explains only a tiny fraction of variability across people. And this is something that gets ignored. When people talk about evaluating schools, they talk about educational policy, almost always using test scores, and that's a wrong approach. So I'll just make a point and leave this behind with you. The way that much social policy gets done, and this is why we wanted a Department of Human Capital, not a Department of Crime, not a Department of Health, because we should really understand that one notion is that we should solve problems as they arise. So if we have a problem with crime, we get more police. That's one obvious answer to that question. What we've come to understand, for example, is how powerful influencing the early years are in shaping the participation in crime. There's a very well-established body of work by a psychologist and epidemiologist named Terry Moffat at Duke and at University College London. And she's established, you know, this question is, you know, when do these problems emerge? Is it more efficient to start early and treat or start later? Obviously, for some problems, treat the problem once you see a problem. But what we've come to understand is that early prevention is very efficient. And so there's a principle out there which is used a lot and which actually has a lot of empirical support. In the handout that you have access to, you can actually see the data supporting it. But about 20% of the actors account for about 80% of the social problems. This is from long-term longitudinal studies, and they show the powerful importance of the early years. And what we can really see is that things that are tip-offs at a relatively early age are very important predictors, things that we can screen. And if we attack early enough, we can actually make major differences. And I'll show you exactly how important it is. I just don't have time to go. But I would repeat again and again that skills are much more than schooling, much more than formal education, much more than scores on tests. We want to think much more broadly about the full range of skills that it takes for human flourishing to occur. And so, for example, we think of motivation, self-regulation. Executive functioning turns out to be a very powerful role. It's a term the psychologists invent, but it's really the ability to adapt and to control one's emotions, and the ability then to provide what I would call agency or dynamism to one's life, to act, to face problems, to address the problems, to recognize the problems, and then to conduct one's life. And these skills emerge early. And I think this is a very important policy opportunity and a very important amendment, I think, to a lot of the discussions about individual choice, even in much of the libertarian doctrine. So anyway, we have a lot of evidence on predictability. I don't have time to go over it now. More than happy to talk about it, or you can look at it. But what we've also come to understand is the importance of the family. And we see, for example, the emergence of skills at a very early age, and how, for example, parenting, attachment, and altruism are very important. So, for example, the term scaffolding is used by a lot of child development experts. And what they talk about in this style is basically the ability to take a child, almost Pygmalion-like style, to build a sculpture, if you will, to build a person. And I'm not talking about shaping them in indoctrination. I'm talking about giving them the capacities to choose their own lives. And that's what I think flourishing needs to be. So to appropriate a term from Sen and Nussbaum, we should think about capabilities, but as a production possibility frontier, a range of choices that people can make. And this is what the new literature talks about, and we have evidence about the power. So I don't have time, but I will just say that it makes a lot of difference for the verbal environment that young children are exposed to for how well they do later on. And so we really have a lot of evidence on this, but I just don't have time to go through it, other than to say there's a dynamism here in the skills. So it's true that very smart and highly motivated children do better at college. There's no denying that. But it's also true that kids who aren't that smart or aren't that motivated at age 3 and 4 can be brought to that level. That is where the dynamics of skill formation has come to be understood. And there are a large variety of programs that have a voluntary component. I'm not talking about a government-run program. I'm not talking about a program like, you know, Hitler Youth or some kind of indoctrination program. Not at all. I'm talking about programs that give parents and children opportunities that they can take or not take. And if they do take it, we can sometimes see substantial benefits. So what I would argue is that there is a powerful role. This is a curve associated with me done years ago, but it's a thought experiment, and it's a thought experiment that has no counterpart in real policy. But it's a useful thought experiment because we ask the self the question, you have a child's life, and you can say, well, where do I put the most resources in a child's life? And the child's just born. It's not even born. It's a homunculus inside the womb of the mother. And you ask yourself, where is the maximum gain? Well, prenatal programs and early programs. And you say, well, why is that true? And that's not saying empirically that job training has no effect. It has a huge effect for those who are motivated and skilled. But what happens is, if we build the skill base, we can then build a life which is filled with choices that these people are able to make to actually promote their own well-being. So I think we have a lot of evidence. Unfortunately, we don't have time, but you will get the handout if you wish, which will show you this. But I will show you, there's one project called Perry Preschool, which did an intervention with disadvantaged children in a suburb, or really a small town just west of Detroit, called Ypsilanti. And these children were all primarily African-American children. They were all at risk. This was in the 1960s. There was an experiment run where they tried a program which essentially was starting to build agency and participation. So the curriculum, if you want to call it that, was the students came in, they planned a task, they did a task, and they reviewed the task collectively, but they also then with the teacher. And there were home visits, teaching the mother how she might be able to facilitate the learning of the child. And what we saw, and we've seen from this and other studies, was an annual rate of return in terms of the investment after tax, all the distortions associated with tax, of 10% return per annum over the lifetime. And we followed these children from their 1960s to they're in their late 50s, and we have this data on how well they've done. And I'll just summarize briefly that not only do these children benefit, but their children's children benefit. So we follow the children. We can see that the home life of those children is expanded. That when the children are young, the parents are more likely to be intact, earnings are likely to be there and support the child and so forth, stable marriage rates and so forth. And not only do the children benefit, but at the same time, the siblings of the children benefit. And again, looking at benefit-cost ratios, you see substantial benefits that are as high as 9, if you count all the intergenerational and cross-sibling effects. I'll just leave you with two graphs and tell you why I think this is important for social mobility. This graph says a lot. It communicates the Perry study. If you look at the column on the left here of this slide, you'll see the correlation between the parent's education and the child's education. And in this population, which is disadvantaged, the correlation is about 0.8. That's for the control group. If you look at the next column, which basically doesn't appear for you, that is basically zero, which means the intergenerational correlation that's very well established as an empirical fact is broken. And if you can do the same thing for crime, again, strong correlation, if your parent was a criminal, you are likely to be a criminal. But when this kind of intervention is done, when these skills are built, when agency and flourishing is really maintained, you're going to see an absence of any correlation. And the same thing is true not only for boys, but also for girls. So I'm over my time, but I want to show you one last figure. This is something that surprises people, and this is why we think there should be a Ministry of Human Capital. One of these programs that originally was designed to boost IQ, this was in the 1960s, early 70s, when at that time everybody thought IQ is the be-all and end-all of human ability and the human capacity and what flourishing was all about. So this program had nothing to do with health, nothing. It was not targeting health. And yet when we follow, again, from a randomized trial, children age 35, males in this case, we look, for example, at the treatment group and the control group. And if you look at these figures, I don't know if you can see them, but you can see the treatment group is far better off in terms of blood pressure, lower blood pressure. You can also see hypertension is substantially reduced. You can see the risks for diabetes, metabolic syndrome, and so forth are reduced. And this gives you something very surprising to many people. Why is it surprising? Well, because this is supposed to be a cognitive program. And what people don't understand is these enriched family environments are not teaching a single skill. They're teaching a way of life. They're teaching flourishing. So the reason why these results appear is not because they were indoctrinated about their health. It's because they developed the skills, the agency of self-control. They could have a certain knowledge. They were able to read the medical instructions and participate very actively. And here, if you look at this particular program, it's even higher rate of return because it's including the health benefits we couldn't measure with PERI. And I'll just leave you with one last thought. And again, this is the notion of intergenerational correlation. We've studied these programs. They're not expensive. And these programs, I keep insisting, are voluntary programs. They're programs at a minimal level, even as minimal as 1 hour a week, where parents are being given advice. Advice at their wish. It's their nobody's telling anybody. And the people talking to these people are not overlords. They're people of the same village, of the same type. They're learning, they're teaching people of their own background and with their own culture the value of interacting with the child and engaging the child. And we have followed this program. This is in Jamaica, very cheap program. It's about 1/20th of the cost of these other programs I was talking about. And if you look at those results at 30, you see main effects, wages higher. You also see college attendance higher. And you can also see that IQ is boosted. Again, something that many people, I know some many conservatives have pointed this out somehow for the waste and the inefficiency of government programs, but here IQ is boosted, which means human capacities are boosted, which means that we can think about people who actively engage their own life. And so I'll just conclude with a similar results from a similar program in Ireland, in the slums of Dublin. Oops, I can't go backward, I guess. Oh boy. I skipped my punchline, but there you go. What I was going to show you was basically in Dublin, a similar program was done. And if you compare the treatment group and the control group, like 10 years out, there's a very high correlation between the parents, the mother's IQ, and the child's IQ, 0.57. That goes essentially to zero. Oh, here, perfectly, sorry. So here we go, for example, on the control group. So we see at age 9, this correlation is about 0.57, very high correlation. If you look at the treatment group, the correlation's fallen to 18.18. Again, intergenerational transmission of disadvantage has actually, or advantage, has actually been weakened. So you're really creating opportunity in a sense of enabling the individual to act, to be dynamic and to shape one's life. And so what I would argue that in summary of my part of the talk, and Carola will take over from this, is that Argentina faces many challenges, we know that. But I would argue one needs to build a culture of dynamism, and it starts at the school. People are very negligent about schools. You have Paulo Freire shaping the agenda, and you have Marxist notions that are really embedded in the school system. You have to understand that that is where people are asking, well, why is it that these reforms aren't taken? Because at an early age, children are not really understanding these capacities, developing these capacities to independently evaluate and to act, and then to understand that some of the ideology that's being forced on them is in fact invalid. So what I would argue is that Argentina should take this notion, cultivate risk-taking, easy to say, but I think we can do that. These people are more creative in the sense they're outgoing, they're engaging, they're active, they're living human beings, flourishing human beings, living up to what their potentials are. But I think we need to go beyond the standard framework of looking only at test scores and what you see from the curriculum of ed schools. My own personal belief is, at least in the United States that I've seen, is a lot of the schools of education have been major sources of intellectual waste and intellectual disorder. It really not creating knowledge, but essentially destroying it and providing curricula instead of learning. And I think that has to be a major change. So thank you very much. And I introduce Carola next, who's my co-author, former student, and very talented human being.
Of Cato Institute and Libertad and Progreso for forming part of this panel of excellence, especially with Professor Heckman, who not only directed my PhD thesis several decades ago, but along the following decades, he has been mentoring all along my career until now. The work he just shown put in the broad spectrum of human capital and even broader human development theory, with hard theory and empirical evidence, as I nobody else in this world does like Professor Heckman. So the evidence is clear, is credible, and is the best you can see. He gathers the evidence. And until it is credible, he never shows any of the results. So it's a luxury to have him here with all his engagements in the US, Denmark, China, and so on. When he came to Argentina the first time, I brought him to help me convince the government to improve the skill formation in Argentina. It was a bit ahead of our time. So 25 years later, in a silver anniversary of that time, we heard about this human capital ministry, and it seemed the right moment to update our paper. So this is a continuation of our paper, and I will go over what we did and what is the data in Argentina and the evidence on how skills are being formed. Well, this I thank you, all the people that collaborated in this paper. So skill formation in Argentina has deficiencies along the line Salke in promoting equality, social mobility, and growth. We have a full life cycle where skills and learning is formed. Learning begins much earlier than formal schooling, 5 or 6 years earlier. This is usually ignored in most of our governments and doesn't end up in schooling. It continues at work. Skills continue to be formed when you enter work and for a very long time. We need to formulate policies that recognize how these skills are formed instead of proceeding with fragmented policies that are usually ineffective because they don't look where the rates of return are higher. As Professor Heckman has researched in several of his best publications, the policy should be prevention or pre-distribution rather than redistribution later on. So we will highlight some. I don't have time to go over all the slides. So we will highlight the early childhood, the first stage, and what happens along the life cycle of the people. As he said, Jim said, parents are the better providers of skills, socio-emotional, character, motivation, a myriad of skills, but not all children have the same motivating parents in early childhood. So the programs he just showed, the Perry program, Jamaican program, provide mainly not schooling or cognitive skills directly to the children, but they motivate their parents to give this information to kids. There are home visitation programs. They start from very early ages. From 0 to 3 years, they are the most effective, and they have these huge rates of return for life. In Argentina, we don't have enough data to calculate early childhood returns on wages or other later outcomes in life. We don't either have data, randomized control trials, and mostly we don't have targeted early childhood programs in this country. So we use PISA data that has cognitive and some non-cognitive outcomes of going to preschool. As we know, Argentina is very backward in PISA scores, not only lower than any country in the OECD, but is also number 66 and in the middle of the Latin American countries. The worst part is that there is a very large gap between children with more educated parents with ways, this gap opens up very early in their lives. So what we did is use this data because we had a big increase in universal preschool at ages 4 and 5. The enrollment increased a lot. At age 5 is almost 100%, but age 4 increased also a lot, much more in the highest quartile of income distribution, as usually happens. What we see, and this was in figure 1 that Jim showed, PISA scores have a high distance between parents with low education and parents with high education. There is one standard deviation of difference, and if we include other wealth, long-term wealth of their parents apart from education, the distance is about 1.6. So what we did is to do an econometric analysis, and we show that with one year of early childhood education decreases this distance in a fifth of the 1.6 standard deviations. But it increases much more to children of low-educated parents, as we expected. Not only that, but part of the skills increase with these programs was through increase in these socio-emotional skills that Professor Heckman was talking, like presentism and perseverance, and a mediation that decreased the effect of early childhood, that directly decreased the impact of early childhood through these non-cognitive skills. Also including what usually is the knowledge that countries use is say to improve readiness, to improve academic performance, we should train teachers, construct more schools, make schooling compulsory. When we add these variables, the effect is very low in most of our regressions. So having parents with motivating kids, having a kid that went early to school, started early, that is explaining most of the return in PISA and not the schooling itself. When we go And in this case, let me finish to saying that the economic case for universal early childhood is weak. Better target programs might cost less to implement and have more results. In Argentina's situation, no hay plata, we cannot spend a lot of money, and we saw earlier in the map of Argentina that I showed that lots of provinces, there is a huge difference in preschool rooms and teachers across provinces. So provinces can do a very effective early childhood program with much less money than preschool that costs about almost 0.5 of GDP. We are talking about $700 against more than $1,700 per kid to improve their situations. So a targeted, high-quality program can be implemented at much less costs. What about now going to schooling investments? We cannot do pre-distribution because the big return is in the early years. So we need to remediate if the children arrive to elementary school and high school without these preschool or early childhood programs. We need to remediate their lack of skills if they come from disadvantaged households. In this case, mentoring is like parenting these kids again, helping them regain socio-emotional skills to have motivation to finish. That's a thing that is not done in many countries and not apparently in Argentina. As I say, they follow usually the recipes of build more school, train teachers, provide free universal schooling. And these kids that come from disadvantaged neighborhoods, families, they need the best teachers. They need much more time from them to recoup, you know, and regain skills. In this case, wages in Argentina and in many countries are fixed. You cannot pay more the teachers that go to dangerous neighborhoods, and you know, and they have to put much more effort in these kids. We can do competition of schools also. We cannot do it them in Argentina because they don't even publish the results from the tests programs. So a voucher could help if people, parents, have information about which school is better. So what are the outcomes of these policies? Very bad cognitive outcomes were, you know, in the back of the PISA scores. And also we have the problem, if you see high school increased a lot from when we were with Jim 25 years ago, so enrollment increased a lot, but dropout continues to be more or less the same. And this is not a problem of credit constraints, it's mostly a problem that do not have the early skills needed to finish. The same happens, well, here we show vintage graphs from that time. So yes, graduation in high school increased, but the dropout continues to be immense and much higher in the lower quartiles of income. University enrollment also increased during the last 20 years. But here, dropout is even larger. They say that the dropout is 40% during the first year. Of course, the dropout is much larger for the people with lower quartiles of income. That, to us, is a measure of earlier skills that these kids acquire. So it's a problem of readiness, maybe, of going to university. They are not ready, they quit. Also a problem that university in Argentina, public university, tends to be free. And you see, here when we divide the sample in private and public universities, we have that most of the kids in public universities are in the first quartile of income distribution. So we are subsidizing the rich to go to private universities. So we are spending a lot of money. This is a graph using data from the OECD. We are spending about more than 1% of GDP. That is higher than the average of the OECD. It's double of what Japan and UK spends on universities. And you see the outcome. We produce much less graduates than any country in the OECD, 19% against 47% with more money. So we are not being very efficient in having people from poor backgrounds finishing university. We are giving free university to people that can pay, and we are not producing so many graduates. Another difference we find is the lower returns to education. High school and university education went down a lot in the last 20 years since we were here. University education had a rate of return 16-17%. That was more or less what you expect from this kind of education. Now it's barely 8%, so it went down a lot, and there are lots of questions, there are lots of theories you can use, but basically it shows it's stagnated, so the stagnation, when you talk about the last 20 years or the last 100 years, maybe the last 20 years were the worst, not only stagnated the macroeconomy, but also stagnated all our human capital. And when you count the real rate of return to university education, when that was 16, now is 8, that's the private return. But when you calculate social return of how much the government spends on each graduate, this goes even lower to 4% and continues going down. This is a real tragedy because we are forming people, graduates, that they want to leave the country. They want to go out, you know, they have the skills, no? That's brain drain. This is an important part of the economy that we are letting go, and I think when the dynamism begins, this should begin to grow again. Is complementary with investment, the investment in human capital. So here you see that tertiary education, that are the yellow part of these are all the countries or most of the countries in Latin America, is basically pro-rich. So you invest in tertiary education, the public spending is mostly going to the rich. The third part that is also very important is when these people that learn, some people learn a lot, most people, and people with bad backgrounds without early childhood, they come with deficiencies to the labor market. And the labor market, what it does is what you can see very fast. We have a very, well, I don't need to tell you here, but we are the country with the highest labor costs in all Latin America. If you see Argentina, is here is almost the same as Brazil. I hope we gain to Brazil next cup, but here we are almost the same, with very bad records of having very high extra wage costs. So these are non-wage costs of labor. What happens to that is that when these are very high, people leave the formal sector. Wages go down in the formal sector. They go to the informal. In Latin America, there is much less unemployment than informality, so people go into the informal sector where skills are even valued less than in the formal sector. So all the skills that were built in the early years are reversed when these people go to the market. This is not only we have this extra wage, extra labor cost, but also we have something we call a subsidy to informality. To all the informal people, we give them basically the same transfers that we give people that are in the formal sector. Non-contributory pensions, moratorias, PUAM, we give them also asignaciones, and the condition is that they are basically informal to accept them. So this is putting a wedge for these people to enter the formal sector. There are lots of papers showing these effects that I don't have time to talk, but you can ask me later. So the skills that are built when you work are much lower in the formal sector in Argentina than in more developed countries. The formal sector is half, and the informal sector is half of the formal sector. Gary Becker, another Nobel Prize, used to say that on-the-job training and learning by doing is about 50% of human capital. Here is 20% at most on the conditions of this country. So here, I think the law is needed in Argentina, the law that is in Congress, to decrease extra labor costs, the rigidity of the labor market is very important, and to begin to decrease the welfare state as soon as the situation for the poor becomes better, because usually all these transfers are timed in other countries, so they don't last forever, is to begin to replace them like they did in the US by a subsidy to formality. So Professor Heckman, Professor Phelps, they advise on subsidies to formality. Instead of giving the asignación universal por hijo to stay at home or say I cannot work or something like that, we give the same money or even more if they go to the formal sector and work, and this was a transformation that was done in the US in the last 20 to 30 years. Now maybe it will be undone. So this shows up in inequality. The educational mobility in Argentina went down. That's a good thing that happened. So you will expect that income mobility education mobility increase. So in this case, the transmission from parents to children, as Jim showed you, is lower. And this is because of all the schooling that was acquired in the later years in Argentina. So you expect that income mobility also will increase. But it increased, but is much less, and it is much higher than the increase in education. This is because skills are not transmitted through education alone. I mean, the having more years of education doesn't mean to have more skills. So we can talk about this later. But the last part is that human capital is not only a policy to improve equity, but also growth, especially in Latin America. Usually, most growth theories talk about the importance of physical capital. Human capital in Latin America is, given the situation we have in most countries, and in Argentina also, is as important as physical capital to improve growth rates. So everyone should pay attention to improve skills and begin in the early years. And this is not a matter of money. You can do it with the same money you have. In this analysis we did in this paper, when you control for the quality of human capital and the investment, private investment, public investment, the sum of those, more expenditure on education doesn't help in growth. So it's not basically spending, but the quality of skills that you build. Well, summary, I leave you later for you, but more or less I've been giving you the lessons. Thank you very much.
Eduardo, please.
Thank you. Robaste el tiempo, no robaste el tiempo. Buenas tardes. Un gusto estar con ustedes. Agradezco a los organizadores y haberme invitado a participar de este panel. Parece que yo soy el único de Sentona porque les voy a hablar de un tema que no está vinculado en forma directa a la educación, sino en forma indirecta, que es capital humano y salud. Y aunque esto parezca un elemento de poca importancia, sin embargo, la salud es un elemento que soporta y que sustenta la posibilidad de adquisición de conocimientos, inversiones, stock, habilidades, destrezas, de los cuales tanto el profesor Heckman como Carola Pesino han hablado, y seguramente el doctor Martín Krause también se extenderá. Y en realidad, todas estas habilidades, la pretensión que tienen es, como se dijo, claramente la generación de rentas a futuro, en el tiempo de que los individuos participan de la vida productiva, y esto, por agregación, permite el desarrollo económico. Acá, con esas palabras, hicimos una pequeña nube de ideas, una nube de palabras, en la cual prácticamente ustedes verán que se repiten los conceptos. 4 elementos centrales que son el entorno social, el entorno ambiental, la educación y la salud como proceso para permitir el desarrollo del capital humano. Este es un trabajo realizado por el profesor Heckman en Jamaica, creo que lo mencionó. Está vinculado a que la intervención económica, pequeñas intervenciones en edades tempranas pueden producir incrementos en los rendimientos en el mercado de trabajo y en la productividad que llegan hasta un 25%. Fue el trabajo sobre que realizado en Jamaica al cual se refirió. Esta es la correlación directa comprobada entre el producto bruto interno de un país y el índice de capital humano. Fíjense que la correlación es prácticamente directa. Hay una línea que se ve perfectamente bien y que establece que esta correlación es directa y positiva. Pero sin embargo, en nuestro país, si ustedes toman la base cero como el indicador promedio de desarrollo de 7 países seleccionados, fíjense que a partir de la década del 50, nuestro país ha tenido una pérdida en su desarrollo económico importante, al punto tal que ha llegado después del año 2010 a superar el 50% en cuanto a esa potencialidad de desarrollo que hubiéramos tenido. La consecuencia es esta. Y obviamente, de esta situación, la perspectiva de adquisición de capital humano se hace mucho más dificultosa. Acá tenemos otro trabajo que está vinculado a lo que se ha mencionado y dice, from the cradle to the labor market, quiere decir de la cuna al mercado de trabajo. Los efectos del peso en el desarrollo y la posibilidad de producción en los adultos. Estas son todas las variables posibles por las cuales la malnutrición se termina por desarrollar en los niños pequeños, la multiplicidad de factores que involucran la malnutrición. Obviamente, que este es un elemento central, también mencionado, y está vinculado a que la posibilidad de adquisición de conocimientos en estas condiciones se hace extremadamente difícil. ¿Por qué? Porque la adversidad afecta el desarrollo del cerebro. Esto plantea que en niños que sufren malnutrición las muestran menores habilidades cognitivas. Pasemos ahora al punto central, ¿cómo puede coparticipar salud en el desarrollo del capital humano? Bueno, nuestra población se encuentra en esta situación. Esta situación es, ustedes verán en el cuadro, un 60% de la población en condiciones de aseguramiento. Y aproximadamente un 40% vinculada a esa población que se encuentra bajo la línea de pobreza, que se encuentra sin ningún tipo de aseguramiento. Esa población es la población que ustedes verán no tiene ningún seguro de salud. Dentro de todo lo que se ha conversado, dentro de todo aquel papel que puede desarrollar salud, el hecho de tener un seguro de salud empodera a las personas y les permite desarrollar de acuerdo a sus preferencias las necesidades de solicitud para su atención. Ese es un punto central que obviamente vamos a ir desarrollando y que en este momento nos coloca en una situación de vulnerabilidad a toda esa población respecto de la perspectiva de adquisición de servicios médicos de calidad y que satisfagan sus preferencias. ¿Qué hacemos en salud en este momento? Bueno, me estoy refiriendo a esa población núcleo, ese 40% de la población argentina que se encuentra bajo la línea de pobreza y que no tiene mayores perspectivas que recurrir al hospital público estatal. Voy a tomar las palabras del doctor Venegas Lynch, público estatal. Es decir, del hospital público que nosotros conocemos, hospital público estatal, es el que le brinda los servicios. Y los ministerios también, que desarrollamos programas. ¿Qué son programas? Programas de asistencia, que constituyen un verdadero subsidio a la oferta. Se sostienen en el tiempo sin ningún tipo de evaluación. Promueven una amplia burocracia. Constituyen transferencias que van a las provincias y a los municipios. Finalmente, para que los hospitales hagan lo que se encuentra dentro de sus atribuciones y obligaciones. Por lo tanto, es un sobrepago. Conversando una vez con algún gestor, me dijo, lo que pasa es que se consideran incentivos. Bueno, tampoco lo son, porque igual las cosas no se hacen y muchas veces, en muchos municipios, los intendentes han preferido tercerizarlos para que estos programas se lleven adelante. Se acumulan como capas geológicas y se van superponiendo estos programas y finalmente tienen una gran ineficiencia en los resultados. Respecto de la asistencia de salud, Helkea, en los hospitales públicos estatales, es cautiva esa población del hospital público, sencillamente porque es el único oferente. Es el único oferente, es un mecanismo monopólico en el cual la población se encuentra cautiva sin perspectivas de elegir ningún otro prestador. Constituye esto mismo un subsidio a la oferta. Esto obviamente determina o lleva a la ausencia de incentivos a la mejora y finalmente a las sobreofertas, porque todo aquello que está subsidiado obviamente tiende a multiplicarse. Esto es lo que termina pasando. ¿Gastamos en salud cuánto? El 10% del PBI argentino. Sin embargo, los resultados son iguales a los de aquellos países que gastan el 6% del PBI. Quiere decir que hay 4 puntos del PBI que se pierden por algún mecanismo de ineficiencia, por corrupción, por aquellas cuestiones que ustedes imaginarán, pero fundamentalmente tenemos 2 caminos. O gastamos el 10% y hacemos las cosas bien, o empecemos a gastar el 6% y que las cosas sigan como están. Propuestas, estas las hemos trabajado durante mucho tiempo. Quiero agradecer al doctor, al ingeniero Manuel Solanet, que fue con quien comenzamos hace muchos años, no quiero contarlos, las tareas de investigación sobre las reformas del sistema de salud en la Argentina. Y finalmente, y después de muchas vueltas, hemos llegado a concluir algunas cosas y trato de transferirlas a ustedes como conceptos generales y como ideas que podemos discutir posteriormente. En primer lugar, la política prioritaria debiera ser lograr la cobertura universal de salud, incorporando al aseguramiento, o sea, otorgándole un seguro a 19 millones de personas que no se encuentran aseguradas mediante el mecanismo de subsidio a la demanda. Ayer habrán leído en los diarios, el municipio de San Nicolás ha puesto en ejecución un sistema mediante el cual el municipio se encarga de asegurar a las personas carentes que no tienen obra social nacional, que no tienen ningún tipo de cobertura de aseguramiento y que tampoco tienen ningún tipo de empresa de medicina prepaga ni medios suficientes para recurrir a la atención y costearla por sí mismos. Esa población está cautiva del hospital público, esto constituye, como dije, un subsidio a la oferta, hay ausencia de incentivos a la mejora, hay limitaciones enormes en el acceso y eso no le preocupa a nadie, ni tampoco esos hospitales tienen incentivos para la mejora de su calidad y su eficiencia. Esta es la política número uno que debiera llevarse adelante. Afortunadamente, el Ministerio de Salud ha coparticipado de esta iniciativa del municipio de San Nicolás, lo cual me pone realmente contento porque es llevar adelante un paso adelante de algo que en el hospital, que en el ámbito de nuestro país se hace imprescindible como política prioritaria de salud. ¿Quién hace el aseguramiento? Bueno, esto pasó por varias etapas. Hace 2 años yo era un defensor acérrimo de que lo hicieran las provincias, sencillamente porque las provincias no han delegado la función salud a la nación y por lo tanto es responsabilidad primaria de las provincias. Pero podría ser de que uno analizando la situación piense, como dice la Filmina, yo personalmente no veo a los gobernadores con mucha iniciativa para hacer cambios en salud. Se encuentran muy cómodos, hay una zona de confort en la cual se encuentran detenidos y prefieren el statu quo antes de hacer cambios sustantivos. Esta es mi opinión personal. Y por otro lado, cuando uno analiza las constituciones provinciales, uno ve de que no se ha delegado la prestación de servicios de salud, pero nada se habla del financiamiento. O sea que la posibilidad de que se lleve adelante un seguro nacional financiando la población, financiando la demanda, obviamente, la población que vive en todo el país, en las provincias, obviamente, y que no tiene cobertura, podría ser también una perspectiva de aseguramiento por vía nacional. Esto también tiene el criterio de financiar la demanda y obviamente una oferta podría ser que el administrador de esos recursos fueran, en la medida que lo pueden hacer, obviamente no todas lo hacen bien, las obras sociales nacionales, las obras sociales provinciales o aquello que se acuerde. Como bien dice abajo la Filmina, la idea es que esto se lleve adelante, pero es necesario siempre un acuerdo con las provincias. La responsabilidad primaria es de las provincias, pero la responsabilidad final es de la nación. Pero hay otras cuestiones que son responsabilidad exclusiva del gobierno. Un ejemplo es el Instituto Nacional de Servicios Sociales para Jubilados y Pensionados, el PAMI, que tiene la población cautiva, que el Ministerio de Salud tiene muy poca injerencia, la injerencia es marginal, prácticamente está, aparte de intervenido por el poder político y además constituye una caja de financiamiento realmente de la política y no cumple las funciones como se debiera y obviamente tiene un montón de inconvenientes, todo el mundo esto lo sabe, y creo que debiera dejar de ser, y nuestra propuesta, después de todas las que ha habido, porque ha habido muchísimas propuestas de reformas, ha sido la de convertirlo en una obra social nacional, bajo los términos de la ley 23.660, como un agente del seguro de salud. La Superintendencia de Servicios de Salud también debiera llevarse a ser la Agencia Nacional del Seguro de Salud para regular no solamente las obras sociales nacionales, sino también las empresas de medicina prepaga, como sucede hoy, y además de ello, también aquellas personas no aseguradas que se incorporen al seguro. Por lo tanto, debe ser un agente que vaya mucho más allá de lo que sucede hoy. También, a pesar de encontrarse en la órbita del Ministerio, la Superintendencia no es un organismo en el cual el Ministerio de Salud tenga demasiada injerencia. Y pienso, sino que es mucha mayor la preponderancia del poder político. Y pienso que esto es una anomalía que debería corregirse. Otro planteo necesario es generar una agencia de evaluación de tecnologías. Ustedes verán las funciones que les asignamos allí. Creo que en la modificación del PMO el Ministerio está trabajando. Eso me parece loable. Pero pienso que eso es un papel que tiene que asumir la agencia de evaluación de tecnologías que conoce y que está en el métier, obviamente. Los protocolos de diagnóstico y tratamiento, la redefinición de patologías de excepción o aquellas que están por fuera del PMO. Y hay un planteo central, que no lo puse, pero que es ser un mecanismo de asesoramiento y de consejo a las decisiones que toma la justicia en materias de salud. Otra política, la quinta, una política de medicamentos. El medicamento se lleva el 38% aproximadamente, entre el 35 y el 38% del total del gasto en salud. El Fondo Solidario de Redistribución, que es un fondo solidario que está bajo la órbita de la superintendencia, y convertirlo en un reaseguro de patologías de alto costo y baja incidencia para todo el país, pero además primariamente blanquear la situación financiera, porque está desfinanciado. Pero está desfinanciado porque, aunque parezca paradojal, está financiando a los gastos operativos de la superintendencia. Es la primera vez que veo, aparte el Banco Mundial ya señaló la anomalía, de que la superintendencia sea financiada con fondos de los trabajadores, es decir, de aquellos que debe regular. Y finalmente, una modernización del Ministerio de Salud, que esto tiene muchas aristas, fundamentalmente vinculado a los programas, a las secretarías hoy en día existentes, que pienso que deberían tener otra, por lo menos, denominación y otras funciones, pero esto es una cuestión personal y es una sugerencia general que va más allá de un planteo en una conversación como la de hoy. Pienso que sí, lo que se debe buscar es la eficiencia general del sistema. ¿Cuáles son los objetivos? La eficiencia de las instituciones de salud. ¿Por qué? Porque los recursos que se pierden, ese 4% que se pierde en un lugar, está faltando para asignarlos correctamente en otro. Dar mayor libertad a las personas, este es un punto central y está vinculado a la conferencia de nosotros de hoy, la libertad, el renacer de la libertad en la Argentina y en el mundo, obtener mejores resultados sanitarios, por supuesto, y obviamente son esperables, y contribuir como soporte facilitador para la adquisición de capital humano y la vida productiva de las personas. Esta es una diapositiva que les regalo. Todo el trabajo que les acabo de relatar brevemente y cumpliendo bastante bien con el tiempo asignado. Escribí un paper que lo pasé a Libertad y Progreso, que es la fundación a la que le agradezco la posibilidad de trabajar con ellos y generar cosas vinculadas a la salud y a las políticas públicas. Y dando vuelta al significado de las cuestiones, me hago un planteo final, que es cuánto capital humano puede llegar a potenciarse en cuanto a la generación de rentas y productividad si la calidad institucional del país no es la que debiera. Cuando hablo de calidad institucional me refiero a los trabajos que ha realizado el doctor Krause y que son un elemento central para que las oportunidades pretendidas sean realmente brindadas. Muchas gracias.
Bien, Eduardo. There is an anecdote that at the beginning of the 20th century, there was a meeting in Washington, D.C. They were trying to set up a kind of a regional organization, what would many years later be the Organization of American States. And the Minister of Foreign Affairs met there, and they were speaking in English in Washington. But then comes the Argentine Minister of Foreign Affairs, and he started speaking in Spanish. And it seems that there were no translators. And when he then submitted a proposal that Spanish should also be the official language of this future organization, the motion was approved. And once it was approved, he turned into speaking in English. And I'm going to do the same, but the opposite. So I'm going now into Spanish. Okay? Así que cambie y vamos a España. Quiero agradecer a las dos organizaciones que han hecho esto posible, al Cato Institute y a la Fundación Libertad y Progreso. Increíblemente, pertenezco a las dos y también en forma, por primera vez, pertenezco a las dos en la misma posición, en el Consejo Académico de Libertad y Progreso y como un adjunct scholar del Cato Institute. Así que, bueno, gracias a las dos. Y quisiera también, en este momento, honrar la memoria de David Bowes, quien durante décadas fue vicepresidente ejecutivo del Cato Institute y que lamentablemente falleció hace 2 días como resultado de una larga lucha, luego de una larga lucha contra el cáncer. Los resultados, la Argentina, unos 200 años atrás, un grupo de ilustrados argentinos comenzó a desarrollar lo que luego sería un marco institucional que hizo de la Argentina un milagro y que se convirtiera en un caso de esos asombrosos que los llevara a los primeros puestos en términos de ingreso per cápita, progreso, digamos, en términos generales. Esos ilustrados argentinos también establecieron un sistema educativo, tomando muchas ideas de Estados Unidos y de Europa, un sistema que estaba basado en la obligatoriedad de la escuela primaria, la gratuidad de las escuelas, la provisión de escuelas públicas y una serie de contenidos mínimos obligatorios. Como ustedes saben, ese marco institucional de la Argentina le trajo grandes éxitos. Y este marco educativo también tuvo resultados. Si en ese momento más del 80% de la población era analfabeta, en 40 años, eso, 30, 40 años, se había reducido a la mitad y seguiría cayendo luego notoriamente. Pero ese sistema que estos ilustrados liberales habían introducido era con el objetivo de, digamos, educar al soberano para lo que sería un Estado moderno luego. Sin embargo, con el éxito que la economía estaba teniendo, el país se volvió un polo de atracción para enorme cantidad de habitantes. Tengamos en cuenta, por ejemplo, que a principios del siglo XX, algo más del 30% de la población de Buenos Aires no hablaba castellano. Los dirigentes políticos en ese momento se preocuparon probablemente con esta situación y quisieron fortalecer y profundizar estos rasgos del sistema educativo para forjar una identidad nacional. Curiosamente, forjar una identidad nacional de esa forma, a través de la educación compulsiva, porque ya había una cultura que se estaba desarrollando espontáneamente. Esa era la misma época en la cual surgía el tango, surgía el amor por el fútbol, surgía también el culto de la amistad, que es tan importante para los argentinos. Sin embargo, esos rasgos del sistema educativo se profundizaron. Y luego, cuando llega el populismo, ese sistema compulsivo se convierte en un sistema de adoctrinamiento, porque todo sistema compulsivo corre el peligro de caer en un sistema de adoctrinamiento, y eso fue lo que aquí ocurrió. Ya en los primeros años de Perón, en las escuelas primarias se comenzaba con el culto de la personalidad del líder y de Evita Perón, y después tuvimos años de vaivenes, de subes y bajas, de más apertura, menos apertura, pero el sistema comenzó además a no funcionar, como bien lo señaló Carola en su presentación. En las últimas evaluaciones, hay una evaluación nacional que se llama Aprender. Argentina además participa de una que se llama PISA, que es de la OCDE, y otra de la ERCE o TERCE de UNESCO. En las últimas Aprender, el porcentaje de estudiantes de sexto grado que no alcanzan los desempeños satisfactorios en matemáticas es del 48,6% y en lengua del 33,6%. Solo 22 de cada 100 chicos argentinos de 15 años transitan su escolaridad en tiempo y forma, sin repetir ni abandonar, y con el nivel esperado de desempeño en matemática y lectura, según el índice de resultados escolares que hace el Observatorio de Argentinos por la Educación, y una encuesta de otra ONG que se llama Hacer Educación, en marzo del 2023, mostró que el 68% de la población piensa que la educación está peor que hace 30 años, con una nota promedio de 4,89. Es así, el sistema ha sido además copado por la fuerza de los sindicatos organizados, ante padres que no están organizados y por lo tanto han podido obtener todo tipo de privilegios para la dirigencia sindical, no necesariamente para los maestros. Además, por ejemplo, fíjense, la ley de educación actual prohíbe la difusión de evaluaciones a nivel de institución educativa para no estigmatizar. Y en realidad lo que hace esto es quitarle la información a los padres para poder saber qué escuelas están dando buenos resultados y qué escuelas no lo están dando. Sin embargo, esta cuestión de los resultados es el tema central de la discusión normalmente en el ámbito educativo y por los expertos en educación, pero yo quiero señalar otro que me parece mucho más importante y que no es mencionado en ninguna de esas discusiones. Es decir, hay mucha discusión acerca de cómo debería ser el sistema educativo, como si alguien pudiera pretender saber cuál debe ser ese sistema, teniendo en cuenta la diversidad de preferencias y la diversidad de recursos que existen en nuestra sociedad. Pero me quiero referir al problema que mencioné antes respecto de un sistema que se convierte en un sistema de adoctrinamiento. Y quisiera mostrarles a ustedes algunos ejemplos. En los primeros años, alrededor del 2004-2005, se desarrolló todo un proceso por el cual se diseñaron y se establecieron lo que se llaman núcleos de aprendizaje prioritarios, que son los contenidos obligatorios para todas las escuelas, digo, públicas, privadas, no importa, todas los mismos contenidos. Claro, sí, uno puede elegir entre escuela pública y escuela privada. Es como si a uno le dijeran, sí, usted puede elegir el traje que va a querer, pero va a ser gris. ¿Ok? ¿Pero puede elegirlo? Sí, elija, vaya a la sastrería que quiera, vaya al comercio que quiera, pero el traje es gris. Eso es lo que es el contenido, dejando muy poco margen para las escuelas privadas para que puedan agregar algún contenido adicional. Ese contenido común es un contenido que está... les voy a mostrar algunos ejemplos. Ahí la educación es para... educar en una sociedad donde el principal problema es la desigualdad, donde lo que hay que hacer es luchar por los derechos colectivos, donde la lucha por esos derechos colectivos se hace en la calle, manifestando. Esa es la forma en la cual se obtienen las conquistas sociales que son necesarias para eliminar o reducir supuestamente esa desigualdad. Y le voy a dar a ustedes algunos ejemplos. Les voy a leer algunos de los núcleos de aprendizaje prioritarios. Estos son en dos materias, formación ética y ciudadana es una, y otras son materias de ciencias sociales. Dice uno de ellos, el conocimiento de que en el mundo actual conviven grupos de personas con diferentes costumbres, intereses, orígenes, que acceden de modo desigual a los bienes materiales y simbólicos, tomando ejemplos de nuestro país y de otros países en el mundo. Eso es lo que hay que tratar. No hay ninguna mención a la cooperación social voluntaria que ocurre, por ejemplo, en los mercados. Luego, y estamos hablando de segundo año, alumnos de 7 años, el contenido es este, en formación ética y ciudadana. El ejercicio público de la palabra y el reconocimiento de los efectos sociales de su expresión oral y escrita en la participación en asambleas, en la elaboración de petitorios y cartas, entre otros. 7 años, participación en asambleas. En el año siguiente se le suma la elección de delegados, 8 años, eligiendo delegados para asamblea, para hacer petitorios. Es una formación, quieren formar militantes, ¿no? De sus cambios sociales. Les voy a traer otros, tengo muchos, pero no me da tiempo para todo. Siempre hay un énfasis en los conflictos, no hay ninguna mención del volumen de riqueza que se generó con la llegada del capitalismo y la revolución industrial y la cantidad de gente que pudo salir de la pobreza, dice así el NAP. La comprensión de los cambios que introduce la revolución industrial en las formas de producir, en la conformación de la sociedad y sus conflictos, así como su influencia en las colonias españolas de América. Sobre los beneficios de la revolución industrial, nada, no hay nada. Después, cuando se habla, más adelante, de las relaciones laborales, se habla del conocimiento de los derechos vinculados a las condiciones del trabajo, en particular de los jóvenes, y la reflexión sobre su flexibilización. La flexibilización de la relación laboral acá es considerada como algo claramente negativo. Luego se toman casos, debe enseñarse a los alumnos casos que son tragedias que ha vivido la humanidad. Por supuesto, como van a ver, algunas de las que se mencionan acá, todos estaríamos de acuerdo en que estén allí. Y entre los contenidos, entonces, se menciona, por ejemplo, casos de discriminación y genocidio a los pueblos originarios, el pueblo armenio, el apartheid, el holocausto, Hiroshima y Nagasaki, entre otros. Esos otros no parecen incluir a los gulags o a las víctimas de la Revolución China, ¿no? Según Stéphanie Courtois, en Camboya murieron 2 millones de personas, en China 20 millones, en la Unión Soviética 20 millones, en el Holodomor, en Ucrania 5 millones y en Corea del Norte 2 millones. ¿Alguna mención de esto acá en los núcleos de aprendizaje prioritario? Ninguna. ¿Qué más? Además, el periodo de progreso que tuvo la Argentina es visto de esta forma. El periodo de progreso fines del siglo XVIII, XIX, principios del siglo XX. El análisis de la integración de las economías primario-exportadoras de América Latina en el mercado capitalista internacional entre 1880 y 1930 en relación con la consolidación y crisis de los regímenes político-conservadores oligárquicos, con especial énfasis en la situación argentina. ¿Es esa el aspecto determinante de la historia de América Latina? Luego señalan, por ejemplo, la comprensión del impacto político, ideológico y cultural de la Revolución Cubana en América Latina y de las políticas de intervención de Estados Unidos en la región en el marco de los procesos de descolonización y de la Guerra Fría. Y por último, bueno, en ninguno de estos contenidos hay algo que sea razonable y básico de economía, ¿no? Lo único que aparece específicamente sobre economía, se los leo. Los mercados no existen, ¿no? Lo que existen son las relaciones de poder. Entonces, ¿cuál es el contenido en economía? La reflexión crítica acerca de las relaciones económicas internacionales en el marco de las asimetrías de poder entre Estados, a partir del análisis de los procesos de construcción histórica de los territorios. Estos son los contenidos obligatorios que tienen todas las escuelas aquí. Así que yo creo que esto a mí me parece mucho, o tal vez, más importante que el hecho de que el sistema sea más eficiente o eficiente, porque una pregunta que tenemos que hacernos es ¿eficiente para transmitir qué? ¿Esto? Yo creo que esto es un problema central. He leído ahí muchas citas o referencias de personalidades que dicen la educación es un arma para cambiar el mundo. Bueno, la verdad que los cambios que se producen, es una metáfora, entiendo, claro, los cambios que se producen a través de las armas no siempre han sido favorables, pero preferiría esa frase de Plutarco que dice, la mente no es un envase, un vaso que hay que llenar, es un fuego o una llama que hay que prender. Gracias.